Hi, my name is Saker Kalundeyvel, and I'm a PhD student at Carnegie Mellon. This project was done in collaboration with Bosch Research in Pittsburgh. I now present our work on Canon, a new vulnerability class for in-vehicle networks. So, with all the advanced electronics and fancy features that come with a modern car, remote adversaries have become a real threat. In this context, remote adversaries aim to take control of the software for an in-vehicle ECU through some wireless access point. With this remote control, an adversary can then use this compromised ECU to launch further attacks against the in-vehicle CAN bus. While attacks that require physical access can only target a single car, remote attacks can in fact open the door to large-scale attacks, and thus they are a serious concern for the automotive industry. Now, one type of attack that's been a concern is the remote shutdown attack, where an attacker uses the compromised software of one ECU to shut down another victim ECU. While this attack alone can severely disrupt a vehicle, a shutdown attack could be used as a stepping stone for more advanced attacks, such as a masquerade attack. So, of course, the automotive industry has responded to these shutdown attacks with several modern defenses. Here, the goal on the defense side is to detect a shutdown attempt in progress before the shutdown occurs. In general, there are three types of defenses. First, we can use an intrusion detection system, or IDS, to monitor the bus for anomalies. Or we can use secure alternatives to the protocol hardware. And finally, we could monitor the bus voltage for anomalies to detect a shutdown attempt. These defenses appear to be sufficient against shutdown attacks because our current shutdown techniques cannot simultaneously be remote, reliable, and stealthy. I'll now clarify our threat model. We assume the attacker can compromise just a single ECU. They can modify and reflash the ECU software application, but they cannot make physical changes to any hardware. Now, for the attack goals, we essentially want to achieve the same capabilities of an attacker with physical access while operating under the constraints of a remote attacker. Since physical access attacks are considered impractical, physical attacks have not been prioritized for state-of-the-art defenses. Thus, if we could somehow use software to mimic these physical access attacks, then we could be stealthy against modern defenses. In this talk, we introduce a new class of shutdown attack that uses only compromised software to mimic and disrupt physical network signals while bypassing the protocol compliance of the CAN hardware. I now present Canon, a reliable and stealthy remote shutdown attack that leverages the peripheral clock gating feature of unaltered automotive microcontrollers. This attack operates using only an ECU's compromised software, and it can remain stealthy against both a monitoring IDS and proposed secure CAN transceivers. Okay, let's get into some background. When looking at the protocol stack for CAN, there are generally four different layers. First, the automotive microcontroller, or MCU, contains the ECU software. When the software wishes to communicate over CAN, it sends data to the CAN controller, which is basically a finite state machine that converts the data into CAN-specific frames. Then, the CAN transceiver converts the frames into the proper bus voltage, and the frame is then sent bit by bit onto the CAN bus. Of course, multiple ECUs communicate on this network, so the bus's design is a logical AND. If at least one ECU writes a 0 bit, then the value of the bus is a 0 bit as well. There are a few extra protocol details that reveal how CAN is vulnerable to shutdown attacks. To send a CAN frame onto the network, there are a few steps an ECU will take. We can break down the CAN frame into different stages, but the first two are important here. If I want to transmit on the bus, I send my arbitration ID and check that no one overwrites me. Again, 0 bits overwrite 1 bits. Then, once I've won arbitration, I become the only transmitter and transmit my data. I just have to make sure what I send matches what I see on the bus. Now, if for some reason I send a 1 bit and see a 0 bit or vice versa, I'll get an error thinking that something must be wrong with my transmission. So, I follow the error handling protocol for CAN. As we can see from the state diagram, with enough errors, I can enter a shutdown state where I voluntarily remove myself from the network and stop touching the CAN bus. Now, this error handling feature is what some other shutdown attacks often exploit. So, if an attacker can trick an ECU into thinking it's caused so many errors, it will shut itself off, the attacker wins. Looking at prior work on shutdown attacks, one approach uses the compromised ECU to send out spoofed messages as if these messages originated from the victim. By forcing certain bits to mismatch what the victim sends, and by perfectly timing these messages to override a victim, the attacker can trick a victim into shutting itself off. However, this approach isn't very reliable in practice, and the automotive industry has built software-based IDSs that can detect anomalous behavior based on timing, content, and other features. In addition, the industry has also proposed using CAN hardware solutions to detect these spoofed messages. All right, so clearly, the prior work on launching attacks from compromised software can be detected by modern defenses. What if we could somehow compromise the physical vehicle? Let's tap into the CAN bus and modify signals directly. Here we find that IDSs do not produce an alert even for a voltage-based IDS. However, this type of attack isn't taken seriously by the automotive industry since physical access isn't practical. An attacker might as well cut the brake lines, and they can only attack one car at a time. So, I'll now introduce our insight into a new class of shutdown attacks. Our main insight comes from a critical change in the design of modern ECUs, specifically for their microcontrollers. For the purpose of lowering an ECU's total power consumption, designers have implemented a feature called peripheral clock gating. This feature allows us to save energy by controlling when a peripheral is turned on or turned off. To turn on a device, a microcontroller simply provides a peripheral with a clock signal, which allows the peripheral to run. These peripherals are finite state machines, thus they run sequential logic that needs a clock signal to progress. Now let's look at how the architecture had to change to implement this feature. Originally, ECUs used to have an automotive microcontroller with a standalone CAN controller chip. But to implement clock gating, the CAN controller chip was moved to be onboard the same chip as the microcontroller. The key difference here is that before, there was only a data line between the microcontroller and CAN controller, and now there's an added clock signal that the microcontroller produces and passes on to the controller as needed. By looking at the driver code for an automotive microcontroller, we found clock control instructions that are part of the microcontroller's API. Normally, a programmer can use this clock control API to control whether or not the on-chip CAN controller gets the clock. Now, of course, if a programmer can write code to control this clock signal, so can an adversary. Ultimately, we find this feature is also a vulnerability that now grants an adversary the ability to enable and disable the CAN controller's clock at will. To exploit this vulnerability, I'll walk you through two main steps. First, I'll show you how a remote adversary can take control of the CAN clock and perform a basic disruption of the CAN bus. Then I'll show you what an attacker can do once they refine this attack. Now, let's go over an example that should make the implications of this vulnerability very clear. Let's say a compromised ECU is transmitting the set of bits onto the bus as part of a normal transmission. We have some 0 bits and some 1 bits, just like a typical message. Now let's say the remote adversary runs a single line of code that disables the CAN clock right at the 0 bit. If we look at what the compromised ECU transmits up until the clock is disabled, the actual output matches exactly what we expected. However, when we disable the clock here, the finite state machine, that is the CAN controller, is essentially frozen in place. The controller was transmitting a 0 bit, and then it had its clock signal disabled. Without a clock signal, the controller logic cannot progress, and it cannot move on to the next bit. As a result, the remaining bits that the compromised ECU transmits are all zeros. By holding the bus to a dominant 0-bit state, our attacker, by running a single line of code, can disrupt the entire bus and block any other CAN traffic. Now, in the paper, we discuss details to refine this clock control and reliably use software to form physical signals on the CAN bus. So let's see how we can exploit this vulnerability and all that we've covered to create our CANN attack. Here, we give a single CAN message loaded into the compromised ECU that runs our CAN code. This single message is what will allow us to target and shut down a victim ECU. First, we load the attack frame into the compromised ECU's transmit buffer. Then we wait for the interframe spacing, basically when the bus is idle. Then, once we can transmit this message, we transmit the arbitration and control fields and then disable the clock. Two things here. Our ID of 0 gives us the highest priority, so we always win the bus. Also, after we transmit the ID, the compromised ECU now believes it is the bus winner, and all other ECUs stop transmitting. Now, since the other ECUs see that a message stopped for some reason, they produce an error. However, since the compromised ECU has already disabled the clock when this error frame appears, it does not see any kind of error and simply thinks it's about to send the data payload. Now that we've tricked the compromised ECU into thinking that it's still the bus winner, we can simply keep its CAN clock disabled until our victim message appears on the bus. So when the victim message is transmitting its data, our attacker can now craft an error frame using a reliable approach that we detail in the paper. Now with the 64-bit maximum payload for the CAN frame, we can use a pattern of alternating zeros and ones, allowing us to create a total of 32 error frames from just a single CAN frame. So what happens after we inject our first error frame during a victim's message? Well, lucky for the attacker, the victim's CAN controller will try to retransmit the message, so we simply have to create more error frames and target 31 retransmissions. So now that we've attacked a total of 32 victim messages, that is the original victim message and 31 retransmissions, the victim now shuts itself off, as we see from the bus idle. So of course, this setup is not the only way to use the clock gating vulnerability to launch an attack. Our insight gives us a great amount of flexibility in how we can produce an attack, and we also offer alternatives using other parts of the CAN frame. We can create an attack simply using the start of frame bit to create an error frame. We can also use the acknowledgement bit. Both alternatives use only a single bit and do not require transmitting any other data onto the bus, giving us a powerful attack with a very small footprint on the network. We also address how to tackle practical challenges in the paper. For our experiments, we target two vehicles, a 2009 Toyota Prius and a 2017 Ford Focus. We target ECUs in these vehicles by using these two automotive microcontrollers. Think of them as the compromised ECU in our attack. Also, for our prototyping and initial experiments, we use an Arduino Dewey board, which has a similar design as the microchip board. So our first attack. We target the engine ECU of the Ford Focus using the microchip board. We achieve a shutdown attack using the loading firing version of the attack we discussed before, and we can perform a shutdown of the engine ECU in 2 milliseconds. The victim does recover, but we can repeat the attack as needed. We imagine that there could be some future work that investigates how to suppress and then stealthily masquerade as the engine ECU using our work as a launch pad. In another attack, we target the power steering ECU of a Prius using the ST board. We achieve a shutdown in 700 milliseconds using the start of frame bit version of our attack. While this attack has a smaller footprint, it does require more time to be successful, but it still works. The power steering ECU does not auto recover and remains shut down. You can imagine an attacker launching this attack while the vehicle is in motion. We now pit Canon against three defenses used by state-of-the-art techniques that successfully detect other shutdown attacks. First, we build an IDS software application that checks for a significant change in message timing. Another defense we tested was building our own custom secure transceiver that checks the ID of any outgoing messages. Finally, we build a frame-level voltage IDS that looks for a sudden shift in voltage in the middle of the frame. Well, Canon does well against these. It attacks very fast within a single period. It doesn't use full frames, so no outgoing ID to block, and it only induces a small voltage spike during a victim frame. Now we also asked ourselves, well, what if I have a software IDS? Could I simply push an update to detect the Canon attack? Unfortunately, we think it would be difficult for a software IDS to differentiate between this attack and a true fault on an ECU. In our paper, we go over a couple ideas on how this attack can deceive even Canon-aware defenses, forcing a defense solution to exist not only as software. Let's now discuss the important takeaways for this talk. How can we implement some countermeasures against this attack? First, we could build a bitwise voltage spike detector. We can monitor for voltage spikes during a frame transmission. The Canon attack footprint won't be as obvious as the footprint for other attacks, but it is possible. Likewise, if you do on-chip power analysis, say for a host-based IDS, you can monitor for unexpected changes in power, which occurs when the CAN clock is disabled and enabled. This would be a great metric we've seen in our own experiments. In terms of prevention, one idea is to forcibly clear an ECU's transmit buffers when the clock is disabled. If the buffers are cleared, then the attack cannot work. As we've seen, Canon is a software-based attack that mimics a physical attack. We do this by exploiting the peripheral clock gating feature of modern microcontrollers. It is clear that modern defenses need to consider this attack, especially since cannon's flexibility can lead to other advanced attacks. Thank you.